Welcome to the FixSleep Bedtime Stories Channel, your sanctuary for relaxation, meditation, and a peaceful sleep. Immerse yourself in the soothing embrace of sleep-inducing tales, carefully crafted to transport you to mysterious lands. Let the gentle rain and serene sounds of nature accompany you on this journey to relaxation. Say goodbye to restless nights and welcome the embrace of a restful sleep with our magical sleep stories. So, let the tale begin. The Legend of the Time Rose. Chapter 1. The Garden of Time. In the ancient and verdant kingdom of Verdantia, hidden among the sprawling landscapes of emerald woods and rolling hills, lay a garden of such beauty and enchantment that it was spoken of in hushed tones, even in the farthest reaches of the land. This was the Garden of Time, a place bound to the fate of Princess Viola, the cherished daughter of King Alaric the Wise. Princess Viola, with her luminous eyes and hair as dark as the raven's wing, was not only beloved for her grace and kindness, but also for the peculiar magic that held her in its thrall. From the moment of her birth during the rare blooming of the nightshade rose under a blood-red moon, a spell had been cast over her by a forgotten sorcerer, condemning her to a life tethered to the Garden of Time. Within this garden, each rosebush represented a year of Viola's life. As long as the roses bloomed, she remained unchanging, forever the age of 21, an eternal witness to the passing seasons without partaking in the passage of time herself. The garden itself was a tapestry of countless varieties of roses, from the deepest crimson to the purest white, each imbued with the essence of the year it represented. The roses whispered secrets of the past with each rustle of their petals, and the air was always thick with their intoxicating perfume. Winding paths laced the garden, leading curious visitors through the labyrinth of time made manifest in flora. Central to the garden's legend was the eternal blossom rose, a mythical flower said to possess the power to break any spell, no matter how powerful. Its existence was as debated as it was revered, spoken of in ancient scrolls and by wandering minstrels who sang of its fabled beauty. The eternal blossom was not bound by the same magic that held the other roses, and was free to bloom out of sight and reach, hidden in a forgotten part of the realm, known only to those pure of heart and brave of spirit. King Alaric, seeing his daughter's youth perpetually preserved, but her happiness constrained, often wandered the garden's paths, heavy with the burden of her fate. He decreed that many would seek the eternal blossom, but none had returned, lost to legend, or perhaps deterred by the daunting perils that lay beyond the known borders of Verdantia. Princess Viola, for her part, grew to love her roses deeply, conversing with them as if they were old friends. She learned to read the seasons in their growth and decline, finding a semblance of change in the ever-repeating cycles of their lives. Yet, the knowledge of her unending isolation weighed heavily upon her, a solitary figure among the shifting shadows of her timeless sanctuary. The garden was protected by ancient magic, making it invisible to those not meant to find it. It shimmered in and out of the mortal realm, appearing fully only under the silvery light of the full moon. To the uninvited, it was merely a mirage, a whisper of color and fragrance carried on the wind, elusive and intangible. Despite the enchantment that kept her bound, Viola's spirit remained unbroken. She spent her days tending to her roses, studying ancient texts brought to her by the few who could enter the garden, and learning the art of herbalism. Her knowledge of plants and their uses was unmatched, and she became a healer in her own right, albeit to the few woodland creatures that dared wander into her garden, or the lost souls lucky enough to stumble upon her enchanted refuge. One day, as she pruned a particularly old bush that bore silver-edged petals, a new figure appeared at the gates of the garden. It was Prince Thorn of the neighboring kingdom of Thornhaven, known for its formidable knights and expansive libraries. Unlike many who had come before him, drawn by the allure of breaking the enchantment for glory or greed, Thorn was driven by tales of Viola's beauty, yes, but more so by stories of her kindness and the tragic poetry of her fate. His arrival marked the beginning of a new chapter in the legend of the Garden of Time, stirring the petals of fate into a rapid dance. Viola, watching him approach, felt a flutter of hope, mingled with the fear of yet another disappointment. Little did she know, Prince Thorn was not just another would-be hero. His heart held a genuine desire to free her, not for the fame it would bring him, but for the chance to see her live the life she was denied. Thus, in the Garden of Time, as the roses bloomed with renewed vigor, signaling the presence of a true seeker of the eternal blossom, Princess Viola and Prince Thorn's paths converged, woven together by threads of destiny and the fragile hopes of a heart long confined to the boundaries of an enchanted bloom. As Thorn stepped into the garden, the adventure that would define their lives began. Under the watchful eyes of the timeless roses, whispering of a future yet to unfold. Chapter 2, The Quest Begins. As dawn broke over the verdant hills of Thornhaven, Prince Thorn readied himself for the journey that would define his destiny. He was a prince, not of silks and ceremonies, but of sword and spirit, raised among the tales of knights and explorers who ventured beyond the known to the realms of myth and magic. With a heart brimming with purpose and a resolve as sharp as the blade at his side, Thorn set forth on his quest to find the eternal blossom rose, the only hope for Princess Viola's liberation from her timeless enchantment. The first leg of his journey took him across the mystical River of Whispers. Legend had it that the river was formed from the tears of the goddess Morana, wept for her lost love. It was said that those who listened closely could hear whispers of ancient lovers' secrets carried by the waters. Navigating the river required a vessel of silence, one that would not disturb the sacred murmurs. Thorn, mindful of the lore, paddled softly, his boat gliding like a shadow over the still, silvered surface. Upon reaching the opposite bank, Thorn found himself at the edge of the timeless forest, a vast expanse of ancient woodlands where time seemed to stand still. The trees were towering giants, their trunks wide as houses, with leaves that shimmered with an ethereal glow even under the cover of day. Here, the air was thick with enchantment, and every step seemed to take an age. Shadows moved of their own accord, and the light that filtered through the canopy was old, as if it had traveled through eons to reach the forest floor. The path through the timeless forest was unmarked and treacherous. Thorn relied on his instincts and the guidance of a compass enchanted by his kingdom's most skilled sorceress, which pointed not north, but toward one's deepest desire. As he ventured deeper, the forest tested him. Ethereal creatures, guardians of the ancient woods, emerged from the shadows. They challenged Thorn to prove his worth, not through combat, but through wisdom and purity of heart. First, he encountered the Sylvan Sphinx, a creature of bark and leaf, its eyes glowing with a soft green light. It posed riddles that spoke of nature and the cycle of life, puzzles that Thorn needed to solve to pass. With each correct answer, the Sphinx's branches parted, clearing the way forward. Deeper still, he faced the Mirror of Mists, a lake so still it reflected not just the face, but the soul of whoever looked upon its surface. Thorn gazed into the water, confronting the fears and doubts that bound his spirit. The reflection did not flinch. Instead, it offered him a glimpse of his true self, free from the shadows of pretense. Accepting his flaws and strengths alike, the mists around the lake dispersed, revealing the path ahead. Throughout these trials, Thorn's resolve was tested to its limits. Each step forward was a lesson in humility and strength, each challenge a deeper dive into the essence of his quest. With every trial surmounted, Thorn's spirit was tempered, his character honed like steel in the forge of adversity. As days turned into weeks, the prince finally emerged from the timeless forest, his spirit fortified and his purpose clearer than ever. Beyond the forest lay the Valley of Echoes, where every word spoken returned with wisdom from the ancients. It was here that Thorn learned to listen, really listen, to the whispers of the wind and the songs of the stones. Each echo brought advice, warnings, and tales of those who had sought the eternal blossom before him, some triumphant, many more defeated by their own hubris or despair. In the heart of the valley, amidst a circle of standing stones etched with runes of power, Thorn found the map of the lost, an artifact of ancient cartography that revealed the hidden parts of the world. The map was not a static parchment, but a living, changing thing, its landscapes altering as Thorn's understanding of his quest deepened. With the map to guide him, the way to the fabled rose was clear, though perilous, filled with obstacles that only a heart true and brave could overcome. Equipped with the knowledge and revelations gained through his arduous journey, Prince Thorn set his sights on the mountains of the Forgotten Realms, where the eternal blossom was said to bloom, shielded by thorns of despair and hope alike. With each step, the prince moved closer, not just to his goal, but to understanding the true nature of the quest he had undertaken, a journey not just of rescue, but of self-discovery and the realization of what one must be willing to endure for love. Thus, the quest began in earnest, with the heart of a true hero leading the way, through landscapes both wondrous and daunting, toward a destiny that would intertwine forever with that of Princess Viola in the Garden of Time. Chapter 3, Trials of the Heart and Spirit. As Prince Thorn ventured deeper into the uncharted realms of the Forgotten Realms, the landscape changed drastically, and so did the nature of the trials he faced. Gone were the physical barriers of rivers and forests. Now, Thorn encountered challenges that delved deeply into the realms of spirit and emotion, testing his resolve, his courage, and his very soul. The Forgotten Realms was a land touched by the arcane, where the veil between the worlds was thin and magic flowed as freely as water. Here, the air shimmered with a subtle luminescence, and the ground was strewn with gemstones that glowed underfoot, casting eerie lights on the path ahead. The beauty of this place was unparalleled, but it was a beauty laced with danger. Each step forward, a step into the unknown. The first of the spiritual trials Thorn faced was the Grove of Reflections. Here, ancient trees stood guard around a crystal-clear pond. The trees were ancient sentinels, their trunks twisted with time, leaves whispering secrets of old. As Thorn approached the pond, his reflection in the water began to change, showing not his present form, but the faces of those he had loved and lost, those he had wronged, and those who had sacrificed for his journey. Each face brought with it a wave of emotions, forcing Thorn to confront his past actions and decisions. This trial was not about righting wrongs done, but understanding the weight of his choices and learning forgiveness of others, and most importantly, of himself. Thorn spent what seemed like an eternity at that pond, speaking words of regret into the still air, and with each confession, the faces in the water became more peaceful, eventually smiling back at him with acceptance. Beyond the grove, Thorn entered the Hall of Whispers, a cavern where the slightest sound was amplified into a chorus of echoes. Here, the very walls spoke, voices of the past heroes and seekers who had ventured this far. Their whispers were not just noises, but voices laden with advice, warnings, and the collective wisdom of ages. Thorn walked slowly through the cavern, listening to the stories of bravery and failure, each tale embedding itself in his heart, teaching him the virtues of patience, humility, and the understanding that even heroes falter. Emerging from the Hall of Whispers, Thorn found himself before the Bridge of Visions. This ethereal bridge spanned a chasm that dropped into a mist-filled abyss, its other side hidden by swirling vapors. As Thorn stepped onto the bridge, visions of possible futures began to play out in the mist, futures of glory and power, of love and peace, but also of despair and defeat. With each step, a new vision confronted him, tempting him with what could be, or terrifying him with what might be should he fail. Crossing the Bridge of Visions required Thorn to focus not on what he hoped to gain for himself, but on the reason for his journey, freeing Princess Viola. Each vision that showed a future without her quickened his resolve, and he learned to let go of personal desires, focusing instead on the commitment he had made, not to the glory of success, but to the spirit of the quest itself. Past the bridge, in the heart of a storm-lashed valley, lay the final trial, the Tempest of Souls. Here, the winds howled with the voices of the discontented. The air was thick with sorrow, and lightning flashed with images of strife and turmoil. Thorn's heart was laid bare, his deepest fears and doubts manifesting as phantoms in the storm. He battled these specters not with sword, but with spirit, affirming his belief in his quest, his love for Viola, and his readiness to sacrifice all for her sake. With each phantom dispelled, the storm abated, and clarity returned. Thorn stood firm in the now peaceful valley, his spirit cleansed, his purpose as clear as the sky after the tempest. He had been tested by the very essence of his being, and had emerged not unscathed, but undeterred and stronger than ever. This trial by heart and spirit transformed Thorn from a mere seeker of glory into a true champion of the heart. Each challenge had peeled back layers of his soul, revealing the core of who he was and who he needed to be for Viola. It was here, in this land of spiritual ordeal, that Thorne truly understood the depth of his commitment and the true meaning of sacrifice. Thus, steeled in heart and spirit, Thorne continued on his journey, now not just as a prince on a quest, but as a man driven by profound love and a newfound understanding of the weight of true devotion. Ahead lay the final leg of his journey, the ascent to the peak where the eternal blossom awaited, guarded by its own ancient magics. But Thorne was no longer the man who had entered the Forgotten Realms. He was now a warrior of the heart, ready to face whatever lay ahead. Chapter 4, The Blossom of Eternity. After enduring trials that tested both his body and spirit, Prince Thorne finally approached the heart of his quest. The discovery of the Eternal Blossom Rose, said to reside on a mystical peak veiled by the mists of eternity. His journey led him to the slopes of Mount Seraph, a place of legends, where the boundaries between the earthly and the divine blurred into the ether. The ascent to Mount Seraph was arduous, its paths steep and treacherous. The mountain was shrouded in a perpetual mist that seemed to be spun from the very breath of the gods. As Thorne climbed higher, the air thinned and the temperature dropped, the ground beneath his feet covered in a carpet of frost that glittered under the celestial light of the moon. The summit of Mount Seraph was a place few had reached, and even fewer had returned from. It was said that this was the cradle of the winds and the birthplace of the dawn. Here, at the peak, stood the Garden of Eternity, a sacred place where time itself seemed to stand still, and at its center, protected by a labyrinth of crystalline thorns, was the Eternal Blossom Rose. As Thorne approached the garden, he felt a profound sense of awe. The flowers here were unlike any he had seen before, their colors vibrant against the snowy backdrop, each petal seemingly imbued with the light of stars. The air was filled with a fragrance so potent, it was intoxicating, carrying with it the essence of life and the whispers of immortality. The eternal blossom itself was in the heart of the garden, glowing softly amidst a thicket of thorns that shone like glass. Its petals were of a color that no painter could capture, a radiant fusion of dawn's first blush and the last glow of sunset. The blossom was larger than any rose Thorne had ever seen, its beauty otherworldly, its presence almost holy. As Thorne stood before the blossom, he realized the final trial was not one of reaching the rose, but of retrieving it. The thorns around the blossom were not merely physical barriers, but manifestations of all the fears and doubts he had overcome along his journey. To reach the rose, he had to relive each of those challenges in his mind, reaffirming the lessons and strengths he had gained. With each step towards the rose, Thorne faced his past, the uncertainties of the Grove of Reflections, the voices of the Hall of Whispers, the tempting futures of the Bridge of Visions, and the phantoms of the Tempest of Souls. Each memory was a thorn, each doubt a barrier to overcome. But Thorne, transformed by his trials, moved forward with a heart full of purpose and a spirit steeled by resolve. Reaching out, Thorne finally touched the eternal blossom. The moment his fingers brushed against the petals, a wave of warmth surged through him, a feeling of profound peace and fulfillment. It was as if the very essence of the universe affirmed his journey, acknowledging his sacrifices and his growth. With gentle care, he cut the blossom from its thorny hold, the barriers seeming to melt away at his touch, recognizing him as worthy. The descent from the mountain was a journey of reflection for Thorn. With the eternal blossom secure, his mind replayed every moment of his quest, each step imbued with newfound understanding and appreciation for the trials he had endured. He saw not just the hardships, but the beauty in each test, the purpose behind each challenge, and the love that had driven him onward. Upon returning to the Garden of Time, Thorn found Princess Viola waiting, as timeless as ever amid her roses, which seemed to lean towards her with affection. The garden was alive with anticipation, the air vibrating with the magic of the impending spellbreak. Approaching Viola, Thorn presented the eternal blossom. As she took the flower from his hands, a radiant light enveloped them both, the magic of the garden responding to the presence of the blossom. The roses around them began to wilt, their petals falling like a gentle rain, each one a year of Viola's life that had passed unexperienced. As the last petal fell, the spell was broken. Viola, for the first time in decades, felt the flow of time return to her. She aged not a day, but gained a lifetime of moments in the blink of an eye, her eyes reflecting the wisdom of her years, yet the brightness of a future finally within grasp. Together, Thorn and Viola walked out of the Garden of Time, the gates closing behind them, with a soft whisper of farewell from the roses. The world outside awaited them, not just as individuals, but as a couple shaped by destiny and refined by the trials of a quest that had changed them both deeply. They knew the road ahead would be filled with new challenges and adventures, but they faced it together, strengthened by the trials they had overcome and the love that had grown between them, as eternal as the blossom that had brought them together.